By thanking each of you for being here. I know your thoughts and your prayers, your cards have brought so much support to Jackie and the family, so much comfort in this difficult time. But I'd like to open up with a word of prayer if we could. Father God, we thank you for your amazing grace, the type of grace, Lord, that carries us through this time of sorrow and loss. Lord, you promise in your word that you're close to the brokenhearted. So, Father, I pray that you would comfort us in this time of loss and sorrow, that you would be our refuge and our strength, O Lord, and that you would lift us from the depths of our grief into the peace and light of your presence. In Christ Jesus' name I pray. Amen. We come today to honor and celebrate the life of a wonderful man and friend to many, Mr. Jim Biddle. I'd like to read his obituary at this time. James R. Jim Biddle, 70, formerly of Newman, Illinois, passed away on Wednesday, October 16th, surrounded by his family. His parents, Donna Biddle and Everett and Pauline Biddle, preceded him in death. Jim graduated from Newman High School and attended Illinois State University from 1972 to 1977. When his father had an accident, Jim left college to help on the farm, leaving himself one class short of graduating. 48 years later, at the age of 70, he received his degree in business and was looking forward to walking with the graduating class of 2025. Jim enjoyed all sports and as a young man played competitive softball. He was an avid Cardinals and the Bears fan, which he continued to follow throughout his entire life. Jim also held season tickets for all Illini football and basketball games for many, many years. Jim was a lifelong farmer in Newman and a proud member of the American Soybean Association, which he served as a national director for many years. He and his wife Jackie became snowbirds in 2013 when they moved to the LRV, a 55-plus community in the Haines City, Florida, and eventually moved there full-time in 2022. Jim loved to make people smile and laugh, so he often wore bright, outlandish outfits to accomplish his goal. His real passion, however, was taking daily pictures of sunsets, which he religiously posted on Facebook for all his friends and family to enjoy. Jim is survived by his wife, Jackie, and three children, Aaron and Lori Bullier of Villa Grove, Adam Bullier of Sydney, Australia, and Prudence and Brad Blumenschein of Muhammad. Jim was grandfather to four grandchildren, Zachary, Aaron, Angelica, and Frankie. He had two loving sisters, Marcia and husband Pete, Paulette and Jeff Schrieffer. Uncle Jim was very close to his nephews, Nate and wife Chrissy, Ken and Sarah and Brandon Perkins, John and Megan Schrieffer, and Matt and Michelle Schrieffer. Jim also had nine great nieces and nephews. When I think of Jim, I think back to when I first met Jim, and it was years ago when I used to hang around a little bit here in Newman, long before I was a pastor. But I've known Jackie and Jim together for many, many years, and always considered them such dear, dear friends. My wife actually worked at Northrop King in Tuscola about 25 to 30 years ago, and that's where she met Jim. She said he would come in and talk to the manager or drop off seed. And everyone always enjoyed Jim and his friendly personality. Jim loved people. And he was the type of guy who, as they say, never met a stranger. And if he did, they would become best of friends by the end of their first conversation. I believe Jim was a hard worker. And I believe he was a good farmer. My wife bragged about Jim a little bit. Jim's beans were the best beans that they brought into the plant. She didn't know what he did differently, but they were the best. It was also around that time when I still had my construction business. I was blessed to have built Jim and Jackie's home just north of Newman. And I can honestly say that they were some of my nicest customers, probably the nicest customers I've ever had. And they were so, so easy to work for. And when it came to the house, Jackie knew what she wanted. And Jim was always okay with whatever Jackie wanted. He just wanted to make Jackie happy. But I do remember this, how that house started out in just an empty bean field or cornfield. And Jim said, I need to plant a windbreak here. So he planted a windbreak around the house, and he kept planting trees and kept planting trees and kept planting trees. And what started out as an empty bean field is now, I'll call it the Biddle Forest. It's a Biddle Forest. You can barely see the house because of all the trees. Jackie told me the other day, she was always telling her friends, well, guess what? Jim planted another tree. Jim and Jackie were married 36 years, blessed with 36 years of loving each other, sharing life and making memories together. Jackie, I know Jim loved you with his whole heart. You could see it every time he looked at you and you looked at him. Jim's love for Jackie, and not just Jackie, but his whole family, was always so obvious. He would do anything for you guys. The Bible says where your treasure is, there will be your heart also. You all definitely were Jim's greatest earthly treasure and the joy of his heart. I would say Jim was always young at heart. And to look at these pictures, yes, he was young. He loved to make people laugh and had a great gift for doing that. Jackie said Jim had his own sense of fashion. He put on some of the craziest outfits and hats you've ever seen. And I think he got worse as he got older. He didn't care what people thought, though. Jim didn't care. And I like that about Jim. I know this too about Jim. Jim loved children. He loved kids. And he loved to dress up as Santa Claus, Jackie told me. And I would have bet he made the best Santa Claus ever. Jackie said he would dress up for St. Patrick's Day. And I did see that picture over there. And I guess that was a sight to see. He also loved to wear his loud Florida shirts and caps. And that definitely caught people's attention. I would say Jim was pretty colorful. In fact, the other day when we met, I said, Jim was definitely colorful. Jackie looked at me and said, that's putting it mildly. Matter of fact, just a couple of weeks ago, after Jim and Jackie came back to town for a little visit, they dropped by the church one Sunday and shared a service with us. And after church, Jim wanted a picture with us all together. And I'll always treasure that picture at that moment. And guess what? Jim was wearing one of those big, flowery Florida shirts. Someone once asked Jackie, do you dress your husband? Jackie looked at the woman and says, just look at my outfit and look at his. Do you think I had anything to do with that? The answer is, no, I did not. The truth is, Jim had such a kind and caring heart. He was always interested in others. When he'd ask you how you're doing, he really wanted to know. When Jim came to church a few weeks ago, he was talking to my son, Austin. Jim asked him about how he was currently doing and what he was involved in, and also what his plans were now that he had graduated from college, the same college that Jim went to. And it struck me at that moment, and I even mentioned it to my wife, Cheryl, that Jim really cared, and he really wanted to hear what my son, Austin, said. They stood there, chatted back and forth for quite some time, and he truly treated my son like he was the only person in the room. Jim genuinely cared for others. The winter before last, when Jim and Jackie dropped by for a church service, they brought up a big bag of crocheted stocking caps for the children in the church or for any school children that might need those caps. They had friends in Florida who lived in their same community who actually knitted those caps together for children that might need them. Jim wanted to bring another bag up with him this time, but Jackie said, we just ran out of room. But Jim still asked, hey, if you need more, we'll get you more. He was ready to bring another bag. Jim was always, always thinking of others. He had such a kind and caring heart. And I know as these days pass, the weeks and even months, memories of special moments are going to come to your mind about Jim. I actually believe memories are a gift from God that help us hold on to our loved ones even after they've gone home to be with Him. These memories will bring peace. They'll become so precious. And the greatest thing we can do is to keep talking about Jim, share him and our stories with each other, continue to talk about the wonderful things that Jim brought into our lives. They'll bring you comfort when you're sad and happiness at just the right moment. And in that way, I believe his legacy will live on forever. But I want to open the floor for anyone that might have a little story or a memory to share about Jim and how he touched your life. You can share it from your seat if you'd like, but I think a good friend of his is going to start us out. Roger is going to come and share a few things. Roger's a good friend of the family.
Thank you. I carried this up, so don't be alarmed. I do this as a roadmap. For those of you that know me, when I get to a microphone, I can talk for an hour. This will keep me from it. So to kind of add on to what was just said, a lot of what I have on here went with that. Like you mentioned, Jim was in high school. He enjoyed sports. We even had a football play. I never played football, but I've heard the team members talk about it. And as far as the quarterback handed off to Jim, and he was supposed to run. And it was, hey, diddle, diddle, send diddle up the middle. He also mentioned Jim's fashion sense. How many of you remember when his mom and dad owned the clothing store here in town? We've been talking to about the lamplighter. They had electrical business too, but they also owned the clothing store. That's where Jim got his fashion sense. That kid, whenever he had a date or whenever he was going to something else, he'd run into that store, pick up a shirt off the rack and a pair of pants off the rack, head out home, get cleaned up, and go on the date. One day I went out to pick him up. We were going somewhere. And I remember I walked by his bedroom door and I looked in. And, you know, he talks about all the colorful clothes he wore and what a fancy dresser he was. There was a rainbow haystack in the corner of that room. I think he just kept getting clothes instead of ever doing laundry. I always wondered what happened to that haystack. It disappeared anyway one day. Jim was always a big, avid Illini fan also. He had season tickets for football, basketball. That's why I wore the orange today. We used to go to a lot of them with him. Those of you that may have gone by when he was tailgating, remember what he always called his world-famous chili. He'd make mimosas and a big pot of chili and a bunch of other snacks, and we'd just spend hours watching the people, and I think as many people were watching us as we were watching them, too. Always had good times doing that, and that chili became famous here in Newman. Whenever we had a benefit or something going on at the local Legion or whatever, Jim would come in and we'd whip up a big pot of that chili. Somebody else would make potato soup, somebody else would make vegetable stew. But Jim's chili was always the one that ran out first. He can make two of those big roasters full of one of the others and it's always gone. I grew up with Jim, and at an early age we ran around, but as we got older, and he was a farmer, I was a farmer, we both had a lot of the same interests. Like you said, he always wanted to do for others. He joined the Soybean Association. I, on the other hand, joined the Corn Grower Organization. But that gave us an opportunity again to spend some time together. We'd travel, go to Commodity Classics and other meetings around the U.S. And that's part of the reason I wore the shirt. This one did both things for me and Jim. But we always had something to talk about, something to debate, give each other good advice while we were working on the issues for farmers. We spent a lifetime together. It's a lifetime of memories. There's a lot of memories I could share, but kind of like Vegas. What happened in our lifetime probably needs to stay some in our lifetime. But I want to thank you all for being here today. Jackie, I know I echo him, how much he loved you, how much we love being with you folks. Marcia, you were a part of our lives growing up too. So I just want to thank everyone for being here and say God bless my son, my friend.
Thank you, Roger. Would there be anyone else that would like to share? Yeah, Brad.
I'll just stay here.
Okay.
I'm not a man of many words. But just wanted to say a few words about Grampy. About Grampy and everything that he did for our family. I married into this crazy family. There's many times I thought about being out of it, but I stuck with it. I would say a big reason for that is my wife, obviously Prudence, who I love greatly. My mother-in-law, who everybody says, is that your mother? I said, no, that's my mother-in-law. Oh, they said, you know, you must love your mother-in-law. I said, yes. I do very much. last thing I'd like to say is thank you to everybody who came to Carl and Barnes. And thank you to all nurses and doctors. There was a few of us that got down there and got to see the care that they gave Jim. And I know John and a few of his other friends can attest to the fact that with Jackie walking around there becoming friends with everybody, they didn't want Jackie to leave, so I think Jackie's got an open invitation to Barnes Jewish Hospital anytime she wants. But for everybody that showed up down there, we know little E and my son Zachary, that Grampy had the best care. He'll be greatly missed, and a great man, and I'm sure when he goes down there, he's looking over us today with some crazy shirt that I probably bought him for Christmas that I regret now somewhat. And he'll be down there at LRV when they have his celebration of life. And I just pray that everybody remembers all the good times that we had, because we had a lot, especially playing fishbowl at Christmas time when he would have to act out certain things and he wasn't allowed to speak, but yet he kept talking anyway. Anybody that's ever played fishbowl would know that Jim didn't do it right, and everybody else didn't. But thank you again for everybody that's shown up on behalf of our family. And like I said, all the people at the hospital just did an amazing job. So thank you, Dwayne.
Thank you, Grant. Before I go on, would there be anyone else that might want to share something?
Yeah. I grew up in Newman. My dad worked for Everett for a long time. And of course I met Marcia and Jim with that. And then I started dating Mike. And Mike and Roger and Jim, there are just no words to describe that threesome, I don't think. I'm not sure if Shirley and Jackie went through what I did getting married to one of them, but it seemed like the other two felt the need to prepare us for that. And I know now why, but Jim particularly took me aside one day, and I thought, okay, here we go. He's going to give me the same talk that I'm sure the others have gotten. And he started in, do you know what you're doing getting married, Mike? Yeah, you know, known him all my life like you, Jim. But then Jim became a different Jim that I didn't know. Little bit of an age difference between Jim and Jackie, as there is between Mike and I. And he wanted to let me know how that was and how wonderful it was. And he knew I was going to be a step-parent, and he took a great deal of time talking to me about that. And how, if you do it right, you'll be blessed beyond measure, because step-kids are the ones you choose. And he couldn't tell me how much that is a blessing to him to have two or three kids. I keep forgetting about Adam because Adam's not around. But to tell me how wonderful that was and how that filled his life. And a few years ago, I pulled him aside. I don't remember now where we were at. It could have been last year when we were down there, but I told him he was right. And I thanked him for that. But he did. When he loved with his whole heart. There wasn't anybody with a bigger heart than that. And I'm so glad we got to see one of his sunsets in person.
Thank you so much. Anyone else want to? Yes.
I just want to say
that Jim was such a huge blessing to our lives. He was, you know, my children's grandfather. house next door to us. Grandma's in a nursing home now, and we would just love if you guys would move to Newman and buy Grandma's house, and then we could be close to the Newman children, because, you know, we lived in Monticello at the time. And, you know, so it's a drive, and he farms, and, you know, they're very busy. And it was a great time in our lives to say yes. And so we packed up and moved. So from the time little Aaron was born, we had moved to Newman and lived next door to them for the 20 years. So, you know, he has been part of raising my children. So, and he was the best. He went to every school event, you know, every, you know, sporting event. And, you know, it really touched me to see all of Aaron's friends here, because, you know, all of Aaron's friends especially knew him so well, just like little Aaron. So I just want to say it was such a blessing to accept that proposal and move to Newman and, you know, raise our children and be next door to them.
Thank you. Anyone else?
I'll say something. I got to clarify this. It's a heavy burden on my shoulders, see? Roger said it, some of this stuff needs to be unsaid. But I'm going to clarify this for the family. Those of you who've been good friends with Jim know we called him Little Fella. Okay. Now, Marcia, you'll know how this came about. We had football practice one morning. Later that day, I believe it was, of course, Mike, Marty Davis, myself, Mike Topi, Justin House, we were all classmates together. I had a 57 Chevy. Jim had met this girl. Roger, he probably rode over to the WIC with you because Jim didn't have his driver's license yet. And he met a girl in Tuscola. So I told him, I said, well, we'll go over there this afternoon. We'll find her, because I had a girlfriend over there too. And I said, we'll find her. And so Wade Johnson was going to come along, Justin House. We went to the lamplighter and we walked in, and his mother Donna was there. And we said, hey, we're here to pick up Jim. Oh, he's not here. And he was supposed to meet us there. I said, what do you mean he's not here? Well, he's at home. Well, we'll go out there and get him. Well, you shouldn't. He's so tired. She said, he's probably taking a nap after that football practice. She said, the poor little feller, she said, he's just worn out. And I'm looking, about that time, Wade Johnson said, I understand, the poor feller. And then she said, bless his heart, the little fella's just worn out. And Wade Johnson said, we understand. Little feller, he's worn out. So we didn't bother him, but we got to football practice that night. We had the two a days. And when we walked in, hey, little fella. And Wade Johnson's like, well, bless your heart. Are you ready to practice today? So that's where we shortened it up to feller. But then he comes in the next year, we're juniors, and he said, I went up in our hay mow. And he said, I moved everything around, and he said, we got a place to play basketball. So if we could play basketball in the winter. I said, well, that would be great. He goes, yeah, Feller Fieldhouse. So that's where we all went to play basketball. And then we're all out at the Shell. Everybody would gather at the Shell. It's kind of a central place to have fun. And we're there, and staying at the motel was a whole group of guys. And they were from Cairo. They came in to eat. Now, everybody knows where Cairo is? They were all black. We didn't have any black people new. We get to talking to them. Next thing I know, little feller has got him going to Feller's Fieldhouse to play basketball. And Roger, those guys could jump. Good. But that was one of the best ones. And then, of course, we had to make up a song about him, too. So as you probably remember the song Rubber Ducky. We just inserted Little Feller. And those of you who come off Sesame Street, so we would sing that, but that would make him mad when we did that. But Tom McGruder did say, hey, diddle diddle, run the Biddle up the middle. God bless him. One of these days we'll be seeing you, Jim. Take care. Thank you. God bless y'all.
Thank you so much. Anyone else? You know, I think of that story that I read in the obituary about him having to leave college because of an accident his father was in, and 45 years later gets his degree. And I think that took a lot of determination most people wouldn't bother him. But Jim was determined that he got it done. Anyone else that might want to share anything? Well, let me say this today. In the bigger picture of all, Jim's life wasn't just about family and friends. It was also about his faith and his trust in his Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And because of that today, this isn't the end for Jim. It's a brand new beginning. Jim grew up in the Newman Methodist Church. I believe his faith was important, an important part of his life. I believe he might have been quiet about his faith, but I believe it was important because I see Jesus' life reflected through Jim in so many ways. Jim truly let the heart of Christ shine through everything he did, whether it was with family or friends or even perfect strangers. Jim shared his life with others in a way that lifted you up, encouraged you. I'm just so thankful that Jim and Jackie came to church a few weeks ago, and I never dreamed it would be the last time I would see Jim on this side of eternity. The Bible tells us that life is but a vapor. It's here for a moment and then it's gone, no matter how long we live. I believe today that just shows us that we should treasure life, the gift of life that God has given us, and also the gift of each other. Treasure and love one another. Sometimes it's hard to understand why things happen, but I can say God always has a plan. We may not understand it, but God has a plan. Jesus himself says, I am the resurrection and the life. Anyone who believes in me will live even after dying. And I love this quote. Death is not the enemy when you know something far better is on its way. Scripture gives us a promise. It says, for those who trust in Jesus, when we leave this world for the next, they're more alive now than ever before. Paul says in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 6 and 8, so we are always confident, knowing that while we are at home in the body, that means here on this earth, we are absent from the Lord, for we walk by faith, not by sight. But here's the promise for believers. We are confident, yes, well pleased, rather, to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord. When we die, believers go directly into the presence of Almighty God. No delays, no detours. No layovers, immediately into his presence. All of our life, most of us have heard people talk about heaven, how wonderful it's going to be in the streets of gold, being reunited with loved ones that have gone on before us. Well, for Jim, today, that is a reality. The moment Jim took his last breath here on earth, he immediately breathed in heaven's air. Can you imagine Jim taking his first breath in heaven? And the first time he opened his eyes, he sees Almighty God. Scripture tells us that eye has not seen, ear has not heard, what the Lord has prepared for those that love him. Heaven is so beautiful that it's indescribable. But you know what makes heaven so wonderful? It's Christ. It's Jesus Christ. There are many beautiful things in heaven, but the most important and the most magnificent thing is that God himself is there. That's what makes heaven home. Jesus said, and if I go to prepare a place for you, he's talking about heaven, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, you may be also. In Isaiah chapter 6, when Isaiah the prophet shared his vision about heaven, he begins with four words, I saw the Lord. He saw the Lord. That tells us that God was there. Ezekiel goes on and shares his vision of heaven for eight whole chapters, Ezekiel 40 through 48. And then he sums it all up in one verse, in verse 35, the very last verse of the entire book, and says, and the name of that city from now on will be the Lord is there. There are many beautiful things in heaven, but the most important thing is that God is there. And the truth is, we were all made for something better than this world has to offer. C.S. Lewis once said, the fact that our hearts yearn for something earth can't supply is proof that heaven must be our home. Even though Jim's no longer with us, he's very much alive. He's just changed his address from this world to the city of God. God is with Jim at this very moment, now and forever. And his promise to those who love him and follow him, those that are devoted to him, is that one day when he calls us home, we can be with him also. My prayer is that all of us here today in our sad moments, we will have those, that we'll remember that today Jim does walk with God. At this moment, he's in the presence of Almighty God, and all of his struggles are now over. Revelation 22, verse 4 says, "And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There shall be no more death, nor sorrow, nor crying, and there shall be no more pain, for the former things have passed away." Jim will never experience hurt, pain, sorrow, or death again, because heaven is a perfect place with a perfect God. In the Bible, the Apostle Paul wrote his last letter of the Bible, in 2 Timothy chapter 4, not long before he died, he said, "I have fought a good fight, I have finished my course, I have kept the faith. Henceforth there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day." I know today, beyond a shadow of a doubt, Jim's fought his good fight of faith. He's finished his course. He's received his eternal reward. And remember this, during the times you struggle with sadness, think about it. God the Father lost his own son on a cross, but was reunited 3 days later. And if you're a Christian, here's the promise. The Christian who dies and the believer who remains will one day meet again. That's going to be an awesome reunion. But to all of us that are left behind, I know this is a hard time to go through. But hold on to the promise that the psalmist makes in Psalms 27. He says, "I am still confident of this. I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living." The land of the living simply means in this life. As hard as it seems right now, as you all go through this loss, I would encourage you to call on Jesus Christ. God in his faithfulness and strength, I know, will see you through. Jim loved beautiful sunsets, took a lot of pictures of sunsets. And I can't think of anything more beautiful than a sunset over a beautiful ocean. This poem I'd like to read is a reminder that even though our loved ones may no longer be visible to us, they continue their journey beyond our sight. And it's a new voyage they're on, welcomed by those in eternity. It says, "I am standing upon the seashore, a ship at my side, spreads her white sails to the moving breeze and starts for the blue ocean. She is an object of beauty and strength. I stand and watch her until at length she hangs like a speck of white cloud, just where the sky and the sky come to mingle with each other. Then someone at my side says, 'There she is gone.' Gone where? Gone from my side, that's all. She's just as large in mast, hull, and spar as she was when she left my side. And she is just as able to bear her load of living freight to her destined port. Her diminished size is in me, not in her. And just at that moment, when someone says, 'There she is gone,' there are other eyes watching her coming, and other voices ready to take up the glad shout, 'Here she comes.' Death is not an end, but a beginning." And I think about that poem. Jim has left this earthly shore, but now he's headed to his eternal shore, God's eternal shore. I know even in this very moment, Jim is also enjoying the company of all those loved ones that have gone on before him. And one day as he stands on that side, he'll be waiting for you and me to come. And so today, let us not think this as being the end. It is a beginning and a brand new life with Christ. Before we close in prayer, I'd like you to listen to a special song. But we're going to do something a little unusual. The frog's going to start this song out. I guess this frog belonged to Jim's father, Everett. And I think this frog sang a little bit of this song at Everett's own funeral service. And Jim wanted to have that included in his service. So I'm going to try to turn the frog on, and then we're going to listen to the song, "The Wonderful Life."
What a wonderful world. see trees of green, red roses too. I see them blue for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Skies of blue and clouds of white, the bright blessed day, the dark sacred night, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow, sky, are also on the faces of people going by. I see friends shaking hands, saying how do they do. They're really saying I love you. I hear babies cry. What a wonderful world. Yes, I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
Jim and I had always said we were going to share him. You know, he done it for a little bit. But we got him back there. So Jackie, I want you to have it. Our shortcuts for you.
Family would like me to announce before I close in prayer, they would like to welcome anyone that wants to accompany them to the cemetery. That would be fine. Jim will be truly missed, but his memory lives on in our hearts and minds forever. And I look forward to the day that we're going to meet once again, one glorious day in heaven. One day the Bible says if we put our trust in Christ as Jim did, we'll see him again, and that'll be forever. We close in prayer, please. Heavenly Father, we've been so blessed by the gift of Jim's life. And we're forever grateful for allowing us to be in his life. I thank you, Lord God, for the light of faith that his life shone everywhere he went. But most of all, I'm thankful for the promise of eternal life that you've given Jim today and forever. Lord, I ask that you would put your loving arms of comfort and strength around this family and these friends today. Help them, help all of us, to keep alive the memories we have of Jim, to bring us comfort and joy. Father, I ask that you would strengthen us with your presence, the presence and power of your Holy Spirit, to know the power of your resurrection today and forever. In Christ's name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Everybody, on behalf of Jackie,